freedom takes green. It's the green, it's the green, it's the green you need. And when I look into your future, it's the green that I see.
Money. It's the green you don't want to run out of. The bread that keeps you fed. You get my point. The issue I personally have with money is having a good and healthy way to spend it. Of course, that means getting into a hobby. And what better hobby is there for an introvert like myself than video games? Hours upon hours of nearly endless content to play through. To keep slashing away at the little time that you have before work calls you back for another 8 to 10 hours a day. So why is it that every game I find interesting to play, free, all of a sudden? From Fortnite to Overwatch to games you may have not even heard, like Phantasy Star Online and Brawlhalla. How do producers and publishers of these titles benefit from the game being free? Well, that's the catch. They aren't. All these titles have an in-game marketplace that would require you to pay a pretty penny to get anything substantial out of. This can be as little as $1, upward to hundreds of dollars in certain item collections. These collections, single items, and well, literally anything you see a price tag on while still playing the game, is called a microtransaction.
The K4, you said.
Yes, I said over $100, you. But I say microtransaction as an all-encompassing term, meaning this includes things like DLCs, gacha rolls, and other things the like. With these being largely popular in titles like Overwatch, Call of Duty 2, the remastered. Soon enough, Elden Ring will be along with this list.
Wait a minute!
Didn't Elden Ring have a price tag on it? Yes, it did. But considering it's now a recently announced DLC, it plays a role into the big question. How can we fix the current state of monetization in gaming? Well, it should be simple. But we first must address the history of the issue. So, let's go back a couple years, almost two decades even, to when Elder Scrolls was just releasing its fourth title, Elder Scrolls Oblivion. In this 2006 title, there was the first large-scale microtransaction to ever be recorded, and received the worst amount of backlash. Thanks to Blizzard now being under fire from the most dedicated Elder Scrolls fans over horse armor, other publishing brands are now holding their tongues on trying to follow suit, despite clearly seeing the rapid potential of such a market, or business model in this case. Seriously? That's what started this whole thing? 17 years later and we get nothing but these cosmetics? What a load of bullshit. We can then flash forward about 9 years where a game called Evolve came out, a little bit after the PS4 release back in 2013. Damn, I feel old. The game itself was rather interesting. What I'm concerned about is with the over $200 worth of downloadable content that went into season passes and monsters, which led to the unfortunate demise of the game. I mean, of course it went under. A company in the right mind would ask their fanbase to buy a $260 game. What if there was no median asking price in the first place? Enter in Games as a Service. Games as a Service are games that are on base, have literally no asking price, but offer bigger and better things to those who are willing to shell some cash. This is where the big names like Genshin Impact and Candy Crush are at. And more importantly, where we start asking the big question, why did they change the business model in the first place? The business model switcheroo had made games like World of Warcraft simply become more common. Instead of having people pay $60 for a whole new game within the same universe, it became free at launch. Any new expansion that you wanted to play, well, you had to pay for. But why? See, according to the Grin's documents, which you can find in the description below, the cost to make is simply overshadowed by the profits made by the production, thanks to whales, gamers who are more than happy to dive into their funds to progress in the game. Much more expediently. And while whales do take up such a small space in the nigh infinite multiverse of gaming, they're responsible for keeping that universe intact. The whales are where the cash is at. Because society is the way it is, those who hold the money hold the power. With that in mind, it's not a wonder as to why the microtransaction business model has become such a staple in the video game universe. On the surface, it's pretty harmless. Companies just want to make the most money that they can to pay back the production costs and get a profit, right? Well, again, that's just a surface level look at things. This is gaming. Gaming is part of the largest collection of social platforms known to modern man. You can't just take anything you see at a glance. See, this chase for profit, or as us younger kids say, securing the bag, has led to the... fuck this word. Ostracization? That's probably as close as I get. Of the majority. Those who pick the game up to get its war worth for free. There are two common types of microtransaction: pay to win, and cosmetics. The latter is very cut and dry in its nature. You see cute, cool looking things, you pay for cute and cool looking things. It's like going to the virtual mall in virtual reality. That, of course, has its own implications, but we're not going to concern ourselves with them. For now. The alternative, being the pay to win option, is the one that causes so much more of a direct headache. We're going to take one of those aforementioned games, Gundam Evolution, for a prime example of this form of microtransaction. Take a look at this. Out of these units, how many do you think you get for free? If your answer was all of them.
Ha! Got him! Got him!
The correct answer is actually 2/3. Now, want to take a guess at how much they all cost? 990 Evo coins. That little gold one right there. Let's just round up and say here, 1,000 coins. 1,000 coins in the store is 10 bucks. So, $10 is what each unit costs on their own. Is the other 1/3 of the units necessary to win? Absolutely not. But do they make it easier and more fun? Well... Again, this is the concept of pay to win. Instead of draining your hours of your time into the game, you drain a bit of cash here and there in the game and boom. You are now the biggest badass in the entire field. Big business wins simply because they have your money. Though, on the player side, it's not so simple. No one likes being met with an I win button all the time. And if that's the only thing the game offers players, well, the only choices you have are to press the button yourself or walk away from the game completely. To put it into simpler terms, when a company produces a cut and dry pay to win game, they have ostracized their current and future player bases that values money more than the hours spent. This sentiment immediately flips on its head, however, when discussing cosmetic microtransactions. Please let me remind you that video games are one of, if not, the most popular forms of socialization to date. Thanks to this massive social sphere, the need to stand out from everyone becomes rather apparent in every other game you play. And if you thought all the stuff before was bad, no. We're just getting started. With cosmetic microtransactions, you either pay for what you see and then that's it, or you pay for a loot box, which has a myriad of things, but only gives you a chance to get the thing that you want. This leads us into the questionable practices and ethics of this business model.
Ethics and morals are completely subjective. As long as you prosper, you need nothing correct.
Loot boxes are probably the most hot topic when it comes to microtransactions as a whole. This is due to a whole slew of things: the money they generate, the cost to produce versus the cost to buy, and the mental health implications that become of these systems. One thing I want to specifically focus on in that second point is the cost to produce versus the cost to buy. The common consensus seems to be, if the cost to produce is less than buying from random chance, it's gambling. If it's the other way around, it's making up the difference. And since we, as consumers, don't know how much time or money it takes to make one outfit in a game, then we as consumers can only assume that the former is true. The issue that's worst here is that big business isn't actively going to out themselves for how much money they make off of loot boxes compared to how much money they use to make the loot boxes. And that's, of course, is just the tip of the iceberg. There have been confirmed allegations of direct correlations between microtransactions and gambling, not just through science, but my own personal experiments. Alright, personal narrative time. This is gonna sound very weird. In the past 4, maybe 5 months, I've spent $8,000, give or take, in just scratches. $8,000 is enough to pay off 1 month of rent for some people. And that's in 4 months. I mean, it's sure, it's stretched out quite a bit. But that means I've been paying $2,000 a month if it's 4 months, and that's not very good. So, how do we fix all of this? The answer, obviously, isn't a very straight one. Nor is it the right one, either. One such way, which benefits the gamers mostly, is to go back. Start paying for the games, pay for the DLC, and you just earn everything on the way. Though, that doesn't help big business as it is now, is it? On the other hand, gamers can just go on strike. Stop playing the games and or stop paying for the cosmetics and microtransactions altogether. This, however, doesn't benefit the players, since they'd be losing out on all these limited time materials or special gear that they need to progress in the game. So, how do we fix it? Let me know what you guys think in the comment section below. If you like the video, go ahead and just hit that like button. And if you want to join the Wayward Souls, go ahead and subscribe. Stick around. It's going to be one hell of a ride. Till next time, friends.